A new investigation finds that forced organ harvesting against prisoners of conscience is still going on in China. In a phone recording, a Chinese surgeon promises undercover investigators they can view the organ supplier before the transplant surgery, making an incriminating confession.
A new investigation shows the practice of forced organ harvesting is still going on in China. A Chinese military doctor told undercover investigators that they can provide organs ready for transplant from Falun Gong practitioners. The series of investigated phone calls were made this January by New York-based nonprofit World Organization to investigate the persecution of Falun Gong. The spiritual practice has been persecuted by the Chinese regime since 1999. The investigator posed as a relative of a patient seeking a kidney transplant. Dr. Li Guowei is a kidney transplant surgeon at Xijing Hospital in Xi'an, China. The hospital is affiliated with China's Air Force Medical University, and most doctors there are with military ranks. The doctor said he could take the patient to see the person whose organ was to be harvested before the surgery. The doctors admitted that they have been using organs from Falun Gong practitioners, but they cannot officially say it that way. In the last phone call with the doctor, the investigator revealed his real identity and tried to persuade the doctor to cooperate with the organization's investigation and help stop the organ harvesting in China. The doctor refused. More investigations of the organization can be seen on their website, upholdjustice.org. Penny Joe, NTD News.
Secretary of State Mike Pompeo lays out the details for how the U.S. will further protect citizens from the Chinese Communist Party's threats. They're expanding the clean network to filter out untrusted mobile carriers, cloud storage, apps, and others.
Well, good afternoon, everyone.
Pompeo started off by reminding Americans to be cautious when traveling, since U.S.-China tensions are rising. But he expressed hope things are changing.
And the good news is the tide is absolutely turning. The central idea of distrust and then verify, I think the world is coming to see is the right approach.
The Clean Network Initiative is being expanded to protect Americans' data from untrusted vendors, such as preventing untrusted cell phone carriers from providing service.
With parent companies based in China, apps like TikTok, WeChat, and others are significant threats to personal data of American citizens, not to mention tools for CCP content censorship. We don't want companies to be complicit in Huawei's human rights abuses or the CCP's surveillance apparatus.
The two other steps are clean cloud and clean cable to protect Americans' personal data as well as companies' intellectual storage and make sure the CCP cannot continue using underwater fiber cables to compromise the information they carry, which connects to the global internet. Melina Weisskopf, NTD News.
The U.S. and Chinese officials are planning to meet later this month to discuss their ongoing trade deal. China is falling behind on its promised purchases of U.S. goods. It's been about half a year since the agreement took effect.
The main negotiators for the U.S.-China trade deal are planning to meet via video conference later this month for a six-month review of the agreement. Under phase one of the trade deal, China said it would buy $200 billion more of U.S. goods over a two-year period when compared to 2017 levels.
America is concerned about China's not, you know, fulfilling its obligation to the contract, not buying enough.
But China is falling far behind its first-year target of a $77 billion increase. Imports of farm goods have been lower than in 2017. Beijing has bought only 5% of the energy products needed for the first year.
I don't think the Chinese government had intention to even, you know, truly implement this deal.
The U.S. has been scrutinizing China over its human rights abuses and draconian national security law over Hong Kong. President Trump has threatened to end the trade deal over China's handling of the CCP virus.
With the economy in trouble, big trouble in China, there's a good chance that this deal will be scrapped.
The latest tension between the world's two largest economies is President Trump's warning to ban the Chinese app TikTok unless it is sold to an American company by next month.
The Department of Education found that U.S. universities failed to report more than $6.5 billion in foreign money over an eight-month period since July 2019. Now lawmakers are asking six universities to submit records about their foreign funding.
Republican Representatives James Comer, Jim Jordan, and Virginia Fox have sent a joint letter to six universities demanding they submit records about their foreign funding. The six are the universities of Chicago, Delaware, and Pennsylvania, as well as Harvard, Yale, and New York University. The three lawmakers made their requests in light of transparency concerns and to help us better understand the foreign influence and investment in U.S. higher education. They are concerned that countries use donations or contract agreements for benefits or quid pro quos. Just recently, former chair of Harvard's chemistry department was charged in relation to participation in a Chinese state-run job recruitment program without disclosing these ties to federal authorities. The three lawmakers specifically named five countries of concern for foreign funding: China, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Russia. For China, the lawmakers want to see records of funding from the Chinese Communist Party, state-affiliated organizations, and businesses located in China.
Seven of Seattle's nine council members support cutting the police department's budget by 50%. They're set on vote on Monday. Both the mayor and police chief reject the idea, saying there's almost no way to do it.
Police Chief Carmen Best and Seattle's mayor spoke out against the council's plan to cut the budget in half.
We think the council is looking in the right places, but in the wrong year. Council has made recommendations now in their new balancing packet, where they basically admitted that the chief and I were right. You can't cut by 50% this year.
This year's budget was $400 million. And Chief Best says if it were cut in half, the department would have to lay off 700 officers. But the police chief and mayor have agreed they do not want to lay off the newest officers. Mayor Durkin has identified $20 million that can be cut from the force's spending, which represents 10% of the remaining budget for this year.
These cuts were driven by the full involvement of the Seattle Police Department and Chief Carmen Best, which is the right way to go about transforming the Seattle Police Department.
She pointed out that the city council has not invited Chief Best to join the discussion about the changes they want to make.
And I believe wholeheartedly that is completely reckless. Council has directed me to lay off 70 or more officers, basically overnight. And I cannot do that in good faith, knowing there are no systems in place to bridge the gap.
Chief Best says she's responsible for keeping the community safe, and it's unacceptable for the council to tell her how to handle the police department. Melina Weiskop, NTD News.
And American Thought Leaders host Yanya Kellick sits down with Colorado Congressman Ken Buck. They discuss what's happening on the streets of Portland, Oregon, and other major U.S. cities, the violence and calls for revolution, and what's at stake for the nation. Representative Buck has a new book out that sheds some light on this topic and others. It's called Capital Freedom: Restoring American Greatness. Here's part of that interview.
One of the interesting things you actually also talk about in the book is that, you know, some of these ideas of multiculturalism diversity, tolerance, and so forth. These are actually all good values, ostensibly, but these are somehow being used to undermine this actual tolerance that you were just describing.
Sure. So I think that the left is very talented at taking words that you and I believe have one meaning and completely changing the meaning. For example, Antifa stands for anti-fascist. They're one of the most fascist organizations that's been in America in our history. They are created to prevent speech that they find objectionable. That is a hallmark of fascism. The idea that we need to be more tolerant. What the left means by that is you need to accept our version of the world. It doesn't mean we have to accept your version of the world. Tolerance only runs one way. We know that tolerance works both ways. Judge certain actions based on the result. Don't just prejudge something as good or bad. And so the left has co-opted language and used it in a way that really fools many Americans. And it's sad because the most tolerant people in this country are Christians. And for some reason, they have been deemed to be haters. If you think about what our command is from our God is to love our neighbor. Our commandment is to love our neighbor. That completely runs contrary to what the left is trying to portray as the Christian spirit.